I think we had a bit of a break of a month while a few of us were away in Australia doing the BizTalk events. So this is the October Connected Systems User Group webcast. So for anybody who's missed the last couple, we've had Josh Twist talking about API management, and we recently had Santosh talking about hybrid connections. And for the third of these meetings, we've got Colin Meade, who's going to talk a little bit about some CRM integration in a hybrid scenario. Before we jump over to Colin, just a couple of quick shout-outs. So we've got sponsorship for the user group from the following companies, and you know, thanks for their support in helping us what we achieve, what we can do. And also the link here for the past events. So if we've got any recordings or any slides from previous events, you should be able to see them from them links. And now I'm going to pass over to Colin and let him enlighten us on CRM integration.
Thanks for that, Mike. Hi, everyone. As Mike was saying there, I'm going to talk to you about hybrid integration with Dynamics CRM Online, Microsoft Azure Service Bus, and AppFX Service Bus. I don't know, can you see the control panel on my slide deck, or is that hidden?
Can't see the controls, but
okay, that's perfect. Okay, so just a little bit about me. I have a broad range of experience working across the Microsoft technology stack, working as a developer, consultant, and architect. My background is in BizTalk Server, and over the last number of years, I've done quite a lot of work with ESB Toolkit in particular, which is always a lot of fun. Recently, I've worked on a number of Azure-based projects, one of which I'll discuss today. I also try and stay as active as I can in the community through my blog, TechNet, Wiki, Twitter, and the Microsoft Technology Group User Group here in Ireland. I'm currently engaged on a large integration project with Quilcha in Ireland as their integration solutions architect. And as you can probably tell from the accent, I'm Irish. We tend to speak at 100 miles per hour, so if I'm talking too fast or there's any mic problems, just give me a shout during the presentation. I've also got I've got 11-month-old twins asleep in the room next to me, so I'm hoping they won't disturb us over the next hour. So what I'm going to cover today is a real-world hybrid integration solution that I worked on for a customer at the beginning of this year. We'll take a run through through the technologies that were used and dive into their key integration features through some demos. I'll also cover some of the difficulties I encountered and how they were resolved or worked around in some cases. So one thing I'd like you to take away from this session is that it's possible to deliver a robust and scalable integration between Dynamics CRM Online and your on-premises line of business systems in a relatively short timescale using the pattern I'll discuss. The solution I'll reference was my first experience working with Dynamics CRM, and outside of some POCs, it was the first real-world Azure Service Bus implementation I worked on. It wasn't all plain sailing, but I was able to go from zero knowledge of Dynamics CRM to delivering a production-ready solution just in a matter of weeks. So let's take a look at the technologies used. In the cloud, we had Dynamics CRM 2013 online and Microsoft Azure Service Bus. So Dynamics CRM is Microsoft's customer relationship management product, and it's geared towards sales, marketing, and customer care sectors mainly. I'm sure the majority of you are already aware of this Azure Service Bus, but for those who are not, it's a cloud-based messaging system that is used to connect applications, services, and devices in the cloud on-premises. So the reason we chose Azure Service Bus was that it facilitated the cloud-to-ground integration pattern that we were implementing. The key benefit it gave us was the ability to decouple Dynamics CRM from the line of business systems, and as well as providing us with a elastic and guaranteed message delivery between Dynamics CRM and those line of business systems. So on-premises, we had AppFX Service Bus hosts that integrated Azure Service Bus with the line of business systems through their WCF and RESTful service interfaces. AppFX Service Bus, for those that are not familiar with it, is a community-based framework for integrating with Microsoft Azure Service Bus. And it was developed by our very own Michael Stevenson based on his invaluable experience building solutions that leverage Azure Service Bus. So this slide depicts the technology architecture. At a high level we have users that perform operations on Dynamics CRM, such as create, update accounts or contacts. Then the Dynamics CRM claims are authenticated with the Azure Access Control service. And once authenticated, the Dynamics CRM remote execution context message is sent to the Azure Service Bus queue. And then on premises we have an AppFX Service Bus Windows service listener that pulls a remote execution context message from the queue, transforms the message to the line of business formats, and finally routes it to the line of business systems. I'll drill into these a bit further later on when I cover the main integration points. So how is all this achieved? In Dynamics CRM, there are a number of key components involved in the integration with Azure that are worth highlighting. The first of these is the remote execution context message. Then we have the event execution pipeline, and also we have some plugins. Data as part of the current Dynamics CRM operation is stored in a remote execution context message. The event execution pipeline is responsible for processing dynamic CRM events either synchronously or asynchronously. And a plugin is basically an event handler that is executed when events is subscribed to or fired at Dynamic CRM. There's two types of plugins that are Azure aware. The first one of these is an out-of-box plugin that's provided with Dynamic CRM called the Service Bus plugin. It contains the logic to post the remote execution context message from Dynamics CRM to the Azure Service Bus. It's also possible to write custom plugins for cases where the Service Bus plugin doesn't meet your requirements. An example of that might be if we needed to manipulate the remote execution context message prior to posting it to the Azure Service Bus. Now, I was able to achieve our requirements using the Service Bus plugin, but I did experiment with the custom plugins during the POC phase and found them straightforward to implement. One thing to be aware of is that the custom plugins are registered to in the sandbox and run under partial trust. So this basically means that they can call any Dynamics CRM SDK methods, any Azure SDK methods or web services. But they wouldn't have access to the local file system, for example. So here we have an illustration of the Dynamics CRM event processing architecture, and I've highlighted in red the main components we just discussed that are responsible for integration with the Azure Service Bus. I won't dive into this diagram. I've just included it for reference and to give some context. And similar to pipelines in BizTalk Server, a Dynamics CRM event execution pipeline consists of a number of stages too. There's four stages, three of which custom plugins can be registered to. They are pre-validation, pre-operation, main operation, and post-operation. Only main operation can have a custom plugin registered to it. Only main operation can't have a custom plugin registered to it. It's for internal use only. The second post-operation stage that you see at on the right-hand side of the diagram is deprecated and only supports CRM 4.0 plugins. Again, I won't drill into the the pipeline stages any further, but it's worth noting that the Service Bus plugin will be registered to one of these, allowing it to be executed either before or after the core platform operation in CRM. So the first integration point of importance is between Dynamics CRM and the Azure Service Bus. In the diagram, we have a user with internet access, Dynamics CRM Online, Azure Access Control Service, and an Azure Service Bus queue. So the event sequence is as follows. The user creates a new contact in Dynamics CRM. This operation triggers the Service Bus plugin to execute. And then the Service Bus plugin authenticates with the Access Control Service and receives a SAML token back to prove it is authorized to call the Service Bus queue. And then the Service Bus plugin posts the remote execution context message containing the details of the create operation from CRM to the Azure Service Bus queue. Okay, so we'll cover the Dynamics CRM to Azure Service Bus integration point in a demo now and just walk through the steps required to enable this. In the interest of time, I won't cover the creation of the Azure Service Bus namespace or the Azure Service Bus queue. Everyone see, can you see that okay? Okay, so I'll continue on. So the first thing we need to do is to download a public certificate from Dynamics CRM. Developer resources within CRM, which you can find under settings. Customization. So there's a number of items that we'll pull from this section of CRM throughout the demo. Okay, so you can see here there's the ability to download the certificate. So we just download that to the file system, and as we're using Dynamics CRM Online, we don't need to configure it for Azure integration. It comes pre-configured. However, for an on-premise instance of Dynamics CRM, there's a number of extra steps required to enable Azure integration. But the first thing we need to do is configure the Access Control Service for CRM integration. And the recommended approach for doing this for a basic scenario is to use the plugin registration tool that is shipped with the CRM SDK. And I'll just launch the plugin registration tool. Now, it's quite a basic tool and user interface. So I'll just run through the steps involved in doing this now. The first thing we need to do is create a new connection. And once we do that, we're prompted with three different fields we need to fill in. So the first one is to give a label. So we just give it a name to identify the connection. So in this case, it's Treadstone Demo. And then we provide it with the discovery URL for the CRM discovery service. And we retrieve that again from developer resources. You can see it here, this service endpoint here, so that gets copied and pasted. It actually gets shortened to this once you save it. Then the next thing and the last thing we need to do is enter a user that allows us to log on to our organization URL. So I'll click Connect here. And once we click Connect, we'll see a list of the organization URLs that the account we've logged on with has access to. In my instance, I just have one here of Treadstone Systems. And you'll see the CRM service URL here that gets pulled back. And we just connect to that organization URL then. Okay, so the next step in configuring Service Bus plugin and for Service Bus integration, and the access control service integration with CRM is to register a new service endpoint. We do that by clicking register new service endpoint, and we're given a screen then with a number of items we need to fill in. I'll just step through one I've already created, which is this Treadstone endpoint. Just click update just so we can view the details of that. So the first two items is just to enter a name and also give it a description. The next item is the solution namespace, which is the Azure Service Bus namespace that we've created. I called it Treadstone. And the path is the path to the queue, the Service Bus queue that we've created, in this case CRM demo. And the next point is the contract that we're going to choose, the service contract that we're going to choose. So as we're using queues, there's actually two items that you'll see in the drop-down that relate to queues. The first one is just called queue, and it's using message buffer, a message buffer queue, which has since been removed from Service Bus, and it's been deprecated within CRM as well. So the recommended contract to use for queues is to use the persistence queue, which we'll select here. There's also the option to send additional user information to the access control service. So this, as you can see here, we have the user ID. We can also attach that to the claim that gets sent to the access control service. I'll choose none here, and when we choose none, it basically just sends the standard claim to the access control service. So at this point, we've filled in configuration information required to register a service endpoint. And the next step that we need to go through then is to register the access control service, or configure the access control service, rather. So we click Save and Configure Access ACS. And again, we're prompted with another screen with three items that we need to fill in. The first of these is the management key, which is we retrieve that from the connection information of our Azure Service Bus namespace. And that corresponds to the default key for the access control service. The next item that we will fill in is the public certificate that we downloaded in the previous step, or at the very start of the demo, rather. So we just browse it out on the file system wherever we've downloaded it to. And the final item then is the issuer name, which is the issuer name of the public certificate. And in this case, we get that again from developer resources within Dynamics CRM. Okay, so once we have all our information filled in, we click Configure ACS. A number of log items will appear on the screen here, and we should get a successful message. Once we do, that's Access Control Service configured for the CRM integration. We click Close, and after that, we'll verify the authentication. So this step just basically does a check to make sure that we can successfully authenticate with the access control service using the details we provided. So we just click Save, verify authentication, and that's that piece complete then. So what we've done at this point is we've configured a Service Bus endpoint, and we've also configured the access control service. So our next step then is to register the Service Bus plugin for an event. And we do that by right-clicking on the service endpoint that we've just created and go to Register New Step. And again, this provides us with a dialog with some details that we need to configure. And again, I'll just walk through one that I've already created, which is Creative Contact. And we'll just take a look at the different items that you need to fill in here. So the very first one is the operation type that we want to subscribe to, that we want the Service Bus plugin event to be triggered for. In this case, it's a create. As you can see here, once you start typing it, it'll autofill. It'll autofill based on the different operations that are available. So you can't type in any garbage here. It needs to be something that's available within Dynamics CRM. The next item is the primary entity that we wish to subscribe to operations on. And in this case, we're going to choose contact. Again, this is autofilled as well. And there's a secondary entity option as well. In this case, we're just going to choose none for that. But you can specify a secondary entity if required. The next two items, event handler and name, are auto-populated by the plugin. So event handler is the service endpoint that this plugin has been registered against. The name is just, it's not of importance, it's just a display name that will show up in the plugin registration tool. The next option is we can select the context that the plugin executes under. So we can select a call-on user, which would be the user that has carried out the operation within Dynamics CRM, orders, maybe service accounts that we wish to run or execute the pipeline under. But that would be selected here, and in this case we'll just use the calling user. And the next item under general configuration, or the last item under general configuration, is the execution order. So this would come into play if we had multiple plugins registered at the same stage of the pipeline. So we can just specify the order we wish those to execute under. Okay, so the next section is the event deck, the stage. We need to select the stage in the event pipeline that we wish the plugin to execute or to be registered under, and then to execute under. The first two, pre-validation and pre-operation, both occur before the main CRM operation. And the final one, which we've selected here, is the post-operation, which will, as the name suggests, will take place after the main CRM operation. And finally, we can select the execution mode. There's two options here. One is to execute immediately, and the other is to queue the operation up and execute at a later time, at a later stage. So the one we select here is asynchronous, which will execute at a later stage. It will be queued up within the CRM queue. Asynchronous is the recommended mode to use for post operations, as it's more performant. And we can enter a description here if we wish. And in this case, it says update, but it would say create if you're creating this for the first time. We just click create then. So just to summarize that, what we've done now is we've configured a service bus endpoint and an access control service. We've also registered a service bus plugin for a create contact event. And we can take a look at this in action now. Just by creating, I'll go into Dynamics CRM, and I'll just quickly create a contact. I'll just put in basic information, just the first name and last name, and click save and close. So what's happening behind the scenes here is the asynchronous server is executing a system job. The post the remote execution context message containing the operation that we've just carried out in CRM, and it posts that remote execution context message to the service bus queue. Under system jobs, which you'll find under settings and administration, and then system job. And I'll just refresh here so we can take a look. You can exit and you'll get a status of succeeded, in which case it's been successfully posted to the service bus queue. If it failed, you would also see details, quite important information if there's any issues in your pipeline or posting it to the Azure Service Bus. So you would see the error details under this section here. So this particular Service Bus Explorer, you should see a new message appear. Yeah, so we've got an active message count of 1 now. And that's basically that demo. So that's what we've successfully integrated CRM with the Azure Service Bus at this point without writing one line of code, which is pretty impressive. So I'll jump back into the slide deck now, and we'll just run through some items gearing towards the next integration point that we're going to cover. Sorry, I'll just go back to this. Okay. So a key component of the integration between Azure Service Bus and the line of business systems is the AppEffect Service Bus framework that I used. Here on the slide, I've detailed some of the main features I considered when choosing the framework. Firstly, AppEffect handles the plumbing associated with Azure Service Bus integration first. So things like listeners, retries, logging, exception handling, etc. It also facilitates a consistent approach to Service Bus integration, which was important for me as we had a number of similar projects in the pipeline. AppEffect allowed me to provide the developers with a proven framework and Service Bus integration pattern that we could roll out across the rest of those projects that were coming down the pipeline. The customer in question didn't have BizTalk server to leverage for their hybrid integrations, and the nature of their business meant that they didn't require such a product. As a result, the lightweight messaging capability of AppEffect was a great fit for their needs. However, the biggest selling point to me, at least, was the ability to fulfill the customer's business needs in a short time frame. We were working to a very tight timelines that resulted in the original POC being used as the foundation for the first drop to test. So I was able to take the core of that logic from the POC, which was mainly the transformation classes, and port them into AppEffect in a matter of hours. That's no exaggeration. So in essence, we were able to go from POC to being production ready overnight. And the second integration point that I'll walk through is between Azure Service Bus and an on-premises line of business system. In the diagram, we have a Service Bus queue, an AppEffect Service Bus host listener, and a line of business system exposed via a web service. The event sequence of this is as follows. So when this AppEffect Service Bus host is started, a listener is registered on Service Bus queue endpoint, and it waits for a message to be placed on the queue. So once a message is published to the queue, the listener will read that message from it. Then the AppEffect Service Bus framework determines the appropriate message handler to use for the message type received, and this is achieved through using the managed extensibility framework. Next, the remote execution context message is transformed to the line of business message format. And then the message format is sent, or sorry, the message is sent to the line of business via web service. And finally, once the message has been successfully sent, the listener deletes the message from the queue. So the following screenshots I've taken from the solution that was built on the AppFX Service Bus framework, and the screenshots really give an overview of the projects and I've also highlighted the key configuration settings that are required. The first point of note is the library section under the solution. This contains the AppFX framework components and its hosts, which will be a console app and a Windows service. The next project you'll see is called Client. This project is used for sending messages to Azure Service Bus. We didn't need to touch this in the project I worked on, as it wasn't required for the cloud-to-ground pattern that we were implementing. The next project is the contracts project. So this project will contain the messages involved in the solution. It'll contain a schema for the message and also a type class which is generated from the schema. And as you can see here, I've got a contact schema that we'll use in the demo. The next project of note is the server project. So this is where the bulk of our code will be. The server project is used for receiving messages from Azure Service Bus. The first thing we need to do is to add a message handler, and in our instance we've added a message handler for the CRM remote execution context message, which you'll see there is named CRM remote execution context handler. I've also added a message helper section to this project. This is something I've just added to house the transformations between the CRM remote execution context format and the different line of business systems formats. So the one I've included here just for the demo purposes is CRM to line of business mock transformations. And the next point of note is the configuration file. So if I've taken a snippet of the main portion of that configuration file. It'll also contain your connection strings, so you'll have your service bus and CRM connection strings within it, and it'll also have app settings, so that's where you can include things like your service endpoints configuration. But the main configuration, which is the one I've included here, is the receiver configuration. This basically allows you to specify a set of listeners which will poll a service bus queue, and it also allows you to specify how many threads to use. But the important keys to highlight here for Dynamics CRM are the default message handler and the replace empty message type. These are two keys that are required due to issues we experience working with the remote execution context message. But I'll cover those issues towards the end of the presentation in a bit more detail. Okay, so now we'll do a quick demo just showing the integration between the Azure Service Bus and an on-premises line of demo, just to sort of close out the end-to-end integration. As you can see here, we still have our active message count of 1, which is the message we created earlier on, the create contact message. For purposes of the demo, I'm just going to output the transform message to the file system just to allow us to see it. I obviously don't have access to the customer's endpoints to demo the actual service, but it'll just give you an idea of how this can be achieved. So just to prove there's no messages there, we can see there's an empty out folder. Okay, so I'll launch a console window here, and what we'll do is we'll run the console host, the AppFX framework console host. Obviously, in a production environment, we use the Windows service to do this, but for development purposes and just for demo purposes, I'll just use the console host. Okay, so I'll just execute that here now. So what's happening behind the scenes here is a listener is being registered on the service bus endpoint. The listener waits for a message we received on the queue. In our case, there's already one there. And then the listener will read the message from the queue. It transforms that message to our line of business format and then routes the message to our line of business system. In this case, we're not going to a service, as I mentioned. We're just going to go to the file system. And as you can see, there's a number of login entries that are output to the screen. They're also output to they can be output to a log file as well on the file system. Okay, so I'll just stop the listener here now. So we should see that there's no more active messages in Service Bus Explorer. So with no more active messages on the queue, it's been received and it's been taken off the queue. And in our output folder, we should now have an XML message, which will be the XML message of the contact I created in the first demo. So it's just a basic contacts schema that I have here, and you can see here it's the first name and surname of the contact we created in CRM earlier on. So this there is some coding involved in this portion of the integration point, but there is very little code involved. Basically, all I had to do was create the transform classes and also the service calls to the different services that we were interfacing with. But outside of that, it was really just configuration that I showed in the previous slide. Just to summarize the end-to-end between the two demos, we integrated CRM with Service Bus, and then we integrated Service Bus with an on-premise line of business system through the AppFX framework, and it was all achieved through very little coding, which is excellent. And I'll just move back into
Colin, just before you jump on, is it possible that you can just show us an example of some of the code that you wrote for that demo?
Sure. Yeah, so my VM is slowing down a bit there now. So yeah, as I showed on the screenshots there, I just moved this control panel out of the way. I showed a screenshot of just the solution itself, and I'll just cover this now in Visual Studio if it loads up. Yeah. So yeah, as I was saying, in the screenshot, I just give you an overview of the solution. In the library, we have, as I mentioned, the different hosts. So there's no code involved in this. This is the AppFX framework that we're provided with, that we build upon. As I mentioned, the client, we didn't have any code in that due to the pattern we were implementing. The schema is very basic schema. It's just title, first name, surname, and again we've the type that's generated from that, and then the bulk of the code is in the server project. So as I was saying, we created a message handler for the CRM remote execution context handler, and that so when you there's a There's a template for creating message handlers within the AppFX framework, and for instance, was the handle method that handles the message that we received. So there's just we're working with brokered messages here, which we receive. One important point to note, and I'll cover it towards the end of the slide deck, is in order to retrieve the message body of a remote execution context message, we have to explicitly specify the remote execution context type, which deviates from the pattern that Mike had originally implemented within AlphaFX framework, where we're using streams. So the remote execution context message is not stream based, which does have an impact on the AlphaFX framework, and it also had an impact with the Service Bus Explorer tool. It wasn't possible to view those messages, the message body within Service Bus Explorer. So you can see there's very, very little code that I had to write in order to handle. Well, the method I've added here, this is just to process the message, which is where I would call the service, the methods to call the service endpoints. As I was saying, in this case, I'm just outputting it to the file system, and it also calls the transformations. So the transformations is just the transformation between a CRM remote execution context message and the line of business system format. So these are all sort of common fields that we would retrieve from within the CRM remote execution context message, and a lot of the samples on the MSDN site will cover a lot of different types of attributes and input parameter sections and things like that. Okay, and then the config, that section I wanted to highlight was, as I mentioned earlier, is just to configure the receivers that we'll use to connect to the Service Bus queue. Mike, is there anything else you'd like me to show within the solution?
No, I think that's okay. I mean, I think just before it was a bit difficult to tie up what the code was doing versus what the console app did when you showed us it before. So yeah, I'm fine with that, but if anybody else feels they'd like to see a bit more there, feel free to shout up or put a comment on the window.
Okay, I will provide this solution as well. I don't have a link for it at the moment, but I'll put this on MSDN code gallery as well. Okay, so. Well, yeah, so I'll just cover some of the issues I encountered. So while the core of the solution was delivered in a short time frame, I did run into a number of issues along the way, some of which were raised with Microsoft, and I've mentioned probably some of them there just as we stepped through the solution. The first two issues are really connected, which is out of date documentation and obsolete samples, in particular the queue contract sample. When I started working on the POC, the documentation was still based on Dynamics CRM 2011. Now that has since been rectified. The 2013 documentation was put up, I think, in April or May of this year, which is good to see. The first sample I started working with to create a Service Bus queue listener, it appeared on the surface to meet my requirement, but I soon discovered that it who was using the message buffers, as I mentioned earlier, which have been removed from the Service Bus version I was working with. So the code in question was never going to work, which sort of threw me for a bit. But then upon reading up on it, I discovered the queue contract is now deprecated within Dynamics CRM, and the persistence queue is the recommended contract for integrating Service Bus queues. The biggest issue, which I touched on there in the solution, the biggest issue that I spent the most time on was around the interoperability of the CRM remote execution context message. So basically, the message itself is not a stream, and as a result, its type must be explicitly specified when retrieving the message body. This affected both the, as I mentioned earlier, affected both the AppFX Service Bus framework and the Service Bus Explorer tool. And another problem that ran into around the remote execution context message was that it was passing an empty label property to the Service Bus queue. And the label property is used by the AppFX framework to determine the message type of messages received and in order to determine the message handler to use. So working with Mike, he was able to quickly introduce support for the remote execution context messages into the framework. However, as I mentioned, having to specify the remote execution context type sort of deviated from the framework slightly, and it's not ideal to have to specify that in code. It would be better to be able to use the stream based process that Mike had initially implemented, and which handled probably 99% of messages. But this was raised with the CRM product team also. And on the Service Bus Explorer tool, I also raised this with Paolo Salvatore to see about adding support to the tool itself. I haven't tested the latest release that was released recently, but so I can't confirm whether that's now supported or not in the tool, but I'm sure it will be at some point in the future. So in summary, today we've covered a real-world integration between Dynamics CRM Online and on-premises line of business systems. We discussed the technologies used, and I gave an overview of the main integration components of each. I also highlighted the main issues experienced. And in closing, my overall experience in working with Dynamics CRM, Azure Service Bus, and AppFX Service Bus was great. But there is room for improvement between Dynamics CRM and Azure Service Bus. Certainly the documentation and samples could be improved upon, as could the interoperability of the remote execution context message. But a main concern I have is that the Dynamics CRM and Azure Service Bus teams are not working in lockstep. Just recently I've come across some issues with the latest Service Bus version 2.4.3. Well, it was the latest version at the time, as 2.4.4 was released on Friday. A change has been introduced in the Azure Management Portal. So when you create a new Service Bus namespace, the ACS, Access Control Service namespace, is not provisioned anymore. And the reason I've heard for this is because ACS has been phased out, and the preferred authentication method is SAS, the Shared Access Authentication. This obviously causes issues for Dynamics CRM, as we've seen in the first demo. It uses the Access Control Service for integration with Service Bus. A workaround for this is to provision the Service Bus from the Microsoft Azure PowerShell. Parameter. Another issue I came across recently was around partitioned entities, and I was receiving an error posting the remote execution context message to a Service Bus queue, which was basically said the client does not support it for partitioned entity, or for a partitioned entity. The current version of Dynamics CRM does not support partitioned entities, but the latest version of the Azure Management Portal enables partitioning by default. So it's little things like these that could result in an IT professional, or worse still, a customer losing some faith in the cloud experience. So lastly, I've included some reference links on a slide here, just that should be useful for anyone embarking on a Dynamics CRM and service Azure Service Bus project. As I mentioned earlier, I don't have a link at the moment for the demo solution, but once I get it cleaned up, I'll add it to the MSDN code gallery and in the coming days, and share the link out. So I'd just like to say thanks to Mike and Saravana for giving me the opportunity to speak here today, and to everyone for listening. Hopefully it's been useful. I'll hand over for some questions now, but if you've any questions after the presentation, feel free to get in touch with me through any of the channels on the slide. So thanks, everyone.
Great. Thanks, Colin. So we've got one question from Dan Johnson, who was asking about your connection string for CRM in the app.config.
Yeah.
For the, he was just asking why you had that in there.
Literally just for the demo. It's been placed in there. But you can use any option you want around that. But there's no real need for it to be there. You can code around that.
Okay, because so I was saying to him, I thought you might be looking up some extra data in the real world or something like that. Is that a pattern that you guys kind of came across, where you'd get the remote execution context message on premise, but then you need to look up a additional contact info that wasn't in the original event?
Oh, sorry, CRM. I'm taking the service bus connection. So yes, that was. It was an issue. It was an issue that we had around attachments and annotations. We found some inconsistent behavior with those. When an attachment is added to an account, so that could be something like an image. We didn't always receive. There wasn't always an event triggered within CRM, so I actually had to code around that and call back out to the organization service in order to retrieve contact. So we were able to trigger the execution. So there was an event. Sorry, there was an event actually executed, but we weren't getting the full details that we required from the attachment or the annotation. We had to actually go back out to CRM to retrieve the values, which wasn't ideal, but obviously in the interest of time, that was something that we had to implement, and it was raised to the CRM product team again. But I'm not sure where that stands with it. I no longer work for that company anymore, so I wasn't around to find out whether that was resolved or not. But as I mentioned, it was quite difficult to get some traction on some of the issues we were raising, because they sat between CRM and Service Bus. I was never really able to get to the bottom of who owned which portion of it. I'm not sure whether the CRM team created the Service Bus plugin or it's the Service Bus team. So that
got a feeling it'll be the. I think it's the CRM team that do it.
I imagine that as well. Yeah, it was quite difficult to get support around any issues we experienced with it.
Cool. And if anyone else has any questions, feel free to unmute your mic and ask them as well.